welcome to the video. This is a serious one, as they all are, but remember, the goal is to have this staggered mind, stupendously staggered mind, with the great good news. And the great good news of this video, the theme is trade the material world in for the monastic world. Trade a material world for a monastic world. Okay. Because this is the choice we have, actually. Now, some new information has come to light about this material world and the future of this material world, which I had not put two and two together yet until this morning. And I was able to get past a barrier where this had been hidden, and they don't want this to get out. I call the goddess, the one who is advertising this materialistic world, the Whore of Babylon, Ishtar, Isis, you know, the goddess who is saying, hey, this material world's great, this is wonderful. Yeah. They're hiding, this is hiding something from us. The future is not great here at all. But the whole purpose of this world is to foster the belief that we've been able to change reality. So we're trying to make it bad. We're trying to make it weird, bizarre, so we can say, there's no way I'm still in reality. I must have separated from it. See, even though it's not true at all. It's impossible to separate from reality. But this world can foster this belief that it's possible. So the marketing of this world is to say, look, this world's great, it's wonderful, you know, you got to stay here, this is where it's at. Hiding the bad part, hiding the bad part. It's like the islands, they come to our island and they have these picture of a palm tree or something. You get to the island, you know, it's just all mosquitoes and malaria and no food or water and violence and crime, you know, just like, oh my gosh, it's horrible. it's like that. So we're saying trade the materialistic world, which is this world, materialistic world, represents this, symbolizes this, for a monastic world, a monastic world. Now, the secular, humanistic materialists hate religion, they hate monasticism, and they want to get rid of it, okay? And they've misrepresented it, and they've brainwash people into thinking that this is the Dark Ages, old medieval times, you know, you want to go back to all that and stuff. They've written history, they've distorted the situation, extremely distorted. Amazing. Because they're rabid anti-religion, anti-liberation from delusion, actually. And so most people have this fear of monasticism. So I've been looking into this, and the more I look into it, the more I say, wow, not only is it not a bad thing, it's like if we knew how good it was, everybody would be lining up for it, actually. As I said in another video, you know, getting into Stanford or Harvard is the booby prize, total booby prize. And this is something I realized early on. I live near Stanford, and it was assumed I'd be going to Stanford, and this is something, a goal, you know. And I could have, if I really, that was my goal, but early on I said, no way, that's the booby prize. Getting into a monastic world is the ultimate, almost the ultimate. The death-free realm, supernature is the ultimate, as far as evaporating our continuity fear and resolving our continuity fear entirely. That's the ultimate. But the monastic world is a super, super, super prize. And far from being boring, if you can see from these videos, I mean, what we're bringing up here is just amazing. Every day you have this opportunity to go further towards freedom, towards recognizing you've always been free. And so it's just like, wow. It's an intense wow all the time. And what I've been showing is that absolutely there are practices, tremendous. You can continuously make variations on practices like a musical composition. And these are wonderful once you get into them, once you break the inertia, You say, my gosh, this is fantastic. I'm so blessed. It's unbelievable. This is what a blessing. Monastic world is a tremendous blessing. There are many, 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 many worlds out there. And certainly ways to get to those worlds. And the aim to get into a monastic world is fantastic. That's the prize. So we're aiming for that prize, actually. We want to sidestep the future of this world. The future of this world, they haven't... actually, nobody's really said what it's going to be like quite. And this morning, I was shown, you know, I saw it, and I said, uh-oh. It's... And eventually this will dawn on people, and they'll say, oh my gosh, we have a problem here. And yet they will not have trained and prepared to go to a monastic world, such as I have. So because of the misrepresentation of monasticism, and the virulent, rabid, you know, anti-sediment by those who have very severe and unacknowledged, by the unrepentant ones, severe continuity fear, we have this lingering, you know, trepidation about or something. Oh, I'm going to, it's like a prison or something. No. No, it affords us the ability to focus our attention, to train our minds, to focus our attention, to use time wisely, and ultimately to realize that there is no world, there is no such thing as existence at all. We've always been spirit. It enables us to realize I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, as God created me. Nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. So, again, when we talk about this world and people are so much competing to get in higher and higher status, all this world is the booby prize, period. A monastic world, getting into a monastic world, is just, you know, is the huge prize. This is what we should be aiming for. This is what I've aimed for my entire life. And that's why I've just disregarded this world and said, forget it. Forget who wants to earn status in this world. That is nonsense. Keep in mind, in a monastic world, you have access, direct access. Sit in meditation, sit in prayer, sit in practice with enlightened ones, liberated ones, non-dual, ones who have non-dual realization, true non-dual realization. Many, you know, and you can't put any, you can't even imagine the value of that. Proper training, proper help, proper focus, and you're able to set this dream down, this dream of determinism. You're able to set it down, and that opens up, you know, infinite, perfect, endless bliss and glory beyond which we cannot even explain. Jesus says you can't even understand or cannot be explained what direct experiencing is really like without subject-object, you see, without dualistic ego and consciousness, without consciousness. See, in reality, there's no consciousness at all. Now, And we may say, oh, you know, some teachers may say, no, you need consciousness in order to experience. That is not true. That is not true. Not at all. So, don't settle for the booby prize. This world is full, it has a lot of dualistic teachers. That's not the prize. It's not the prize. Thinking, oh yeah, this world's going to be a great place. I have these dualistic teachers here telling us, yeah, ego, consciousness, ego, this is fine, this is great. No, it's not. It's not. That's not reality. Reality is direct experiencing. And we cannot, again, conceptualize it or understand it through thoughts at all. And Jesus says you can't really function here in this belief system through direct experiencing. But he says, don't worry, that's okay. You will get there. So exchange the material world for a monastic world. It's so much better that we can't even comprehend, hardly comprehend how much better it is. But I've been trying to, you know, dig in and understand. Now, this world. Hear a helicopter in the distance, right? Well, that's part of the problem. What is the problem in this world? Technology. Okay. GPS, satellite location systems, navigation systems. At super cheap levels, hobbyist levels, combined with hobbyist drones. Okay. Amazon is already setting up fleets of drones to deliver packages. Hobbyist drones are everywhere now. People are using their iPhones to fly them. Okay. It's very simple these days, for those who have the technical know-how, and many hobbyists do. It's very simple to set up drones. And in fact, amateur video people are doing it all over the world right now. It's flying these drones with cameras on in all over the place, taking video. Okay. Well, if you put two and two together, with GPS location systems, with homing devices, the technology now is super easy for those with malevolent intent to target anyone or any building they want whatsoever with drones, hobbyist drones, okay, and putting explosive devices on those things, hobbyist drones, or biochemical weapons, etc., and navigating those drones underneath radar, low, and just coming right exactly to the location that they want, and nobody knows where they came from. You see, this is what I was shown. I said, "Oh, I never thought about that." I said, "Oh my gosh, nobody is safe. How do you defend against that?" You know, we're entering a totally new era of, I say, terrorism and anarchy and feeling unsafe here in this world. And anybody can do this with a smartphone, actually. And these hobbyist drones are easy to get, and how can they stop the proliferation of those? And like Amazon is going to deliver packages. You can attach packages to these drones. You can attach anything you want to them, and then literally fly them. They already have a set navigation how to get exactly to pinpoint within a foot or so, you know, where you want. Amazon's going to drop off these packages on your porch with drones, you know, or just exactly where they, you know, very, very precise. So what's to stop that technology from getting into the wrong hands? And the answer is absolutely nothing. It's already in their hands, I'm sure. And this is like a mind blow. I said, "Oh my gosh, I had not even thought of that." Welcome to the world of robotics. Now, every time that we say, "Oh, I'm going to get on the spiritual path here," something new crops up in the world. You know, that catches your attention, fires your imagination. Well, the next thing is robotics. Okay, it was computers. You know, then the internet, and then smartphones, and you know, MP3 player. MP3 came a little earlier. And now, the next thing is robotics. And that's going to obsess the world. The world is going to be obsessed by robotics. This is what I saw. And the world is going to feel, everyone is going to feel unsafe. We've had this idea that here we're safe, but nobody's going to be safe anymore. You know, when we started using these drones, these military drones, I said, "This is bad news. This is very bad. What's happening?" I had intuition of this. Unmanned, right? Unmanned drones, being able to target through guidance systems, you know, anything on the ground like that. And I said, "Uh-oh, this is really bad." But I didn't realize how bad it was. Now I understand how bad it is. And this is what the goddess doesn't want us to know. The one who is marketing this world, material world, to us and saying, this is your home. This is where you'll be happy. This is where you need to stay. See, she didn't want that known, but I was able to dismiss her finally, get past that, and then see, oh my gosh, this is what she's been hiding. This is what the mother's been hiding. Yeah, doesn't want her children to know about this. So the growth of these hobbyist drones is exponential. The distance, the precision, what they can do with them, it opens up a can of worms in this world. And you can, if you start thinking along these lines, you say, oh my gosh. You know, nothing is safe. Nothing that flies is safe. Nothing is safe. They can remote control these drones from a smartphone. Moving around mobily, you know, it opens up a massive can of worms, totally, across the whole planet. It's theoretically so terrible, you can't even comprehend it, of the mischief, the potential mischief that is now, you know, upon the world. And I said, you know, that's why we say technology, this high technology is not a good thing. It's a curse. It's a curse, actually. We don't need it. We're way less safe than we used to be. Both our finances, our personal identity, our well-being, on and on and on and on and on. We're much, much less safe. You know, we have to have all these firewalls and passwords. And they keep saying, gotta change the password. Your credit card information has been stolen. This is a nightmare here. This is a dystopian nightmare already. And it's about to get way, way worse when certain events will happen. People say, uh-oh, nobody's safe. We can't even protect ourselves from this. This is what's been hidden from us. And I've been trying to tell people my whole life, say, hey, don't trust the goddess, corporate goddess here is marketing this world to you. She's lying, deceiving, hiding from you. But that's what we want. Of course, we want to believe that we have managed to get free, separate from reality, to change the very nature of reality, to say that we're stuck in some terrible situation. See, that's what that's our goal. But even when you give up that goal, you then have you realize you have a severe continuity fear, and you still, you know, embrace this stuff because you're afraid of, oh my gosh, I forgot what being perfect is like. And so it's a nasty situation in the future here, to say the very least. And that we've been warned about this. Scriptures warned us, prophets have warned us. I spent my life warning people. Very few have listened because their heads keep getting turned. Right? In the 60s, we got our heads turned to sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Okay. And people, you know, it's ready, you know, we're on the spiritual path. We're trying, okay, I'm really going to focus. Oops, you know, here's all this distraction. There's always some distraction that says, wow, that's cool. I remember growing up in the West Coast in the 60s, the advertising here just became amazing, and you felt like products and things were so cool because what you had, what the Ron Hicklin singers, and you had the Wrecking Crew, session musicians in LA. And LA became the advertising, marketing, music center of the world, really. And they were able to put all these jingles and these art, they used like the best musicians and the recording techniques and singers and everything to make it seem like these products coming were like, we're entering some beautiful world. You know, it was amazing what they did. And nobody knew what was going on. It was the same people playing on all these records, all these songs, all these commercials. It was the same, but they were super creative, super clever and creative. And it created this sort of fog, this sort of like an LA morning fog, you know, just a mixture of the desert and the ocean, and it turned my head for sure. It was amazing. And then that turned our heads, you know, the British invasion, and then one thing after another, and the Beatles, so I'm saying, and everything else. And it was one thing after the other, you know. And here we are saying, okay, I gotta get ready to train for the monastic world. And wait a minute, you know, this is really cool. Oh, wait a minute, this is cool. And then, of course, the whole here in the Silicon Valley, the computers, microchip, Apple computer, you know, that completely turned everybody's heads here and all around the world eventually, right? The benefit of living in California is this is where the future starts. And so it's possible to already process it and be done with it before most of the people in the world have even, you know, found out about it much. So that's a great benefit, actually. So in other words, I'm already aware of all this stuff and I already said no, processed it, thank you, but no thanks. And now I'm saying monastic world. Trade the material world for the monastic world. Doesn't matter if they're on, was it Hicklin, something like that. I'm not sure if that's the exact, but there's these singers that did the commercial work, you know. They copied from the Beach Boys, actually. The Beach Boys really started a sound in Southern California. What happened was the corporations and the marketing there copied the sound in their commercials and the jingles for radio stations, for instance. And it went all over the country and all over the world. And it was this really, you know, intriguing sound. You think, wow, we're entering a new age here. And you know, nobody really quite knew what was going on, but it was very calculated, very smart. And you wonder why those songs sounded so good. This is the thing. See, we think, no, these people, these musicians are playing their instruments and doing it. No, they're not. The Wrecking Crew was just this incredible group of people, super talented studio musicians. They played on. They're the musicians that provided the soundtrack for all this. I mean, the soundtrack for these songs in the 60s was off the charts because you also had the influence of movie musicians that worked on soundtracks for movies there. And the combination of this, you know, just produced this incredible talented music that just is mind-blowing even in this day. You listen to it and you just say, holy cow. I mean, that's about as sweet as music as you're ever going to hear. And then that was mixed in with materialism, consumer materialism. It made us think that things are going to make us happy, like this music makes us happy. Anyway, you have always something that's turning our heads. Okay, so now we think, okay, now it's time to get down to business. All right, finally, we're kind of over the smartphone thing. And okay, guess what? Here comes roboticism. Here comes remote control. Terrorism. Here comes all this stuff. And that's going to obsess the world. I think it was Bill Gates who said, the next big thing is here. The next $1 trillion industry is here. And it's going to blow your mind. And he says, all this technology is already available. And who was that? Bill Gates. Bill Gates saying this? This is what, several years ago, I think. Those who know realize this is the next head turner. And so people are all saying, okay, Rinpoche, you know, oh, yeah, I'm ready for the spiritual path, and this is great. Oh, roboticism, oh, all this stuff's happening. Oh, whoa, you know, wow. Wow, okay, I'll practice tomorrow. I just want to follow this, what's going on, you know. This is what happens in the world. Now, I was blessed in August 18th, 1999. I had this experience, amazing experience, where my awareness shifted out of this world and I became aware of another world. And I was literally seeing it, experiencing it, perfect, like I was there. And this was like called Gadgetland. And it was a place that was just completely obsessed with robotics, remote control, you know, wireless robotics, and mechanical stuff, high-tech stuff. The whole planet was absolutely, this was their culture, and they were all completely obsessed and buried in this. And you had all sorts of robots and drones in the street going along, little hip, little creatures and various things, robotic creatures everywhere. And I went around this world very looking and experiencing, and after a while I felt like I was gonna die. You know, I said, this is so horrible. My spirit felt like, I felt I was losing touch with my spirit is what happened. And I was like, wow, my body almost died actually here. And it took quite some difficulty to recover my nerves. It was horrible. And I realized this is what's going to happen to this world. And it's truly terrible. So as I say, trade in the material world for the monastic world. The monastic world, where you are able to evaporate your continuity fear, and realize God. Realize that you are God. All is God. And realize your true power and your true freedom. And leave all this nonsense behind, actually, like a bad dream. So the cat's out of the bag now. Cat's out of the bag. I'm suggesting is for people to practice in a monastic way. Get ready for it. Get ready for it. Christians talk about the rapture. Well, where are they going? You know, where are we? Well, you'd go to a monastic world for sure. There may be those who go to these supernatural realm, but there need to be teachers in the monastic world. There need to be those who helping out those who go to a monastic world. And so this is great. This is what I let's see. Let me just drop that for a minute. And not rush forward too fast here. Okay. Because this is starting to bring up like jitters. Okay. There's been this knowing in this world for a long time that at some point there'll be an exodus from this world somehow. The world will get so terrible that there'll be some sort of exodus. So what I would suggest is to at least prepare. This is why it's a win-win. Preparing for a monastic life is a win-win because let's say you could exchange this world, material world, for a monastic world. Okay, great. Huge win. Let's say that doesn't happen, but there's a lot of monastic opportunities in this world. Okay, let's say things work out, so there's a lot of monastic opportunity here in this world. Well, then you'd be prepared for that too. So that's a win too. So it's a win-win situation. And the way to do it is to prove to yourself that you can do it. Prove to yourself you can sit for two hours in contemplation, in hearing, in the burn. Prove to yourself you can do this. Once you prove to yourself you can do it, then you're not so frightened at all. Once you do it for a year straight or 2 years straight, you realize, oh, yeah, I can do it every day. It's not a problem. It's not nearly the problem that we think it is. And in fact, it's not even a problem. It's a fantastic opportunity. It's something that your spirit really, really wants. Say, oh, this is great. Exchanging this world for another world. What a super bargain that is. Leave the whole thing just behind, the whole rotting corpse of this world. All the magazines and the television programs. Imagine how nice that is. Now, if you want to know how this world treats monasticism, just look how the Chinese came into Tibet in the 1950s. And what they did to the monasteries, and what they did to the monastic culture. This should give you a nice understanding of what this world's about right now. That was really one of the greatest centers of monasticism in the world. And it's been, 60 years since that happened? Almost 60 years. I think it was, 1955 or something like around then. So, almost 60 years. Now everybody's wondering, how can these end times be so terrible? Well, just think about drones, okay? That's how it can be so terrible. Cheap, easily accessible, hobbyist drones. This is how things can get really bad in this world. This is how it can get really, really terrible. Attacks against various religions, wars, all sorts of, conflicts and stuff. Targeting, easy to target, pinpoint target anyone you want to at any time, all this stuff. It turns into this nightmare. Now the prophecy, Malachi's prophecy, is that this pope is the last pope. It could very well be the case. So the idea of monasticism isn't such a bad one, actually. But truly, preparing is the way to go. You can't just prepare through a concept. Oh yeah, no, you have to prove to yourself you're capable of it. Be a little bit of adjustment, for sure. A little bit of adjustment. But not so bad. Not so bad. But intense. Probably intense for a while. Like, wow. And the adjustment is, wow, how fortunate we are. That's the adjustment. It's like, oh my gosh. Super fortunate. But earned it, through right effort, right practice. Could you imagine those Tibetan monks and with the Semje monastery who would go to prayer and etc. And who's there? Who's there in the monastery? Longchenpa is there. That's just, I don't even know how to process that. How fortunate they are to have guidance from an awakened, truly awakened, non-dual spiritual master like that. Guidance in contemplation, guidance in spiritual practice. This is the monastic culture, and Tibet really developed it very well. But it will be better. It will be done much, much, much better in the monastic world. But you have help. You have someone saying, okay, full stop on the burn here, don't go any further. And you have guidance counselors, so to speak, spiritual guidance counselors. And they plot the course through, you know, and get you through, and help you succeed. Help you succeed. You know, everyone's pulling in the same direction to help you succeed. Now, of course, we're afraid, like, oh, I don't want to succeed. Well, you'll succeed gradually. Meaning you will move your comfort zone, your familiarity will, you'll gradually get familiar, that's all. Right now you say, the reason why we say I can't succeed is we're not familiar with success. But you get familiar bit by bit by bit by bit, become proficient bit by bit by bit by bit, and then you know, you say, well, I belong here, I can do this. And it's not, you know, what I thought it was, it's not. And I'll just continue and eventually flip the script. I'll be able to flip the script eventually. So this world is really on the rocks, okay? This world is really on the rocks more than we realize. And there'll be measures and countermeasures and technology. Oh, we need more technology, more of this, more of this, more of this. And it just never, we already know what it's like. It's this never-ending collapse into more and more complexity, confusion, insecurity. Truly horrible. Trade the material world for the monastic world. Trade the material world. Just this is just an idea, isn't it? Hey, how about trading the material, this material world, for a monastic world? Monastic world meaning the culture. And all the regulations and what you do, the structure of this world, is based on monasticism. Wherever you go, there are meditation halls, there are contemplation, there are practicing is going on, there are enlightened teachers there. And so you stay on track, you stay on track. You don't get so easily distracted. You don't waste time so much. Now, I don't know exactly how such a world is run, but it's very possible you can make pilgrimages. Some people who have a lot of hyperactive from this world, I imagine they can make pilgrimages and just go from one monastic center to the next, so they can feel that they're getting somewhere by walking and hiking and something like that. And gradually they'll settle down, they'll decide to stay in one of the monastic centers and begin to practice more and more and more like that. That is similar to India, to Tibet, to the places that have set up, to the Middle Ages, Christianity. Similar, right? There's a lot of pilgrimages going on. Some people are not ready to be able to handle the sitting quietly for a lot of the day and focusing, and they want to be super active. So they may do pilgrimages. And so the communities will be monastic communities, and there'll be one here, and there'll be one there, and there, and there, and there, and there. And that's all there is on the monastic planet. There's just monastic communities and spiritual retreats. And so there can be pilgrim paths all over the planet. And people who, again, feel they need to do that can do that. this world, seeing this morning, it flipped the script on this world. Ethically very feasible, and no doubt will be utilized in the future. That changes everything. It's a completely different world. With the ability of any knucklehead, young kid, to command a drone with a lethal load, you know, hobbyist drone. And really very little way that we can protect against that. You just have a free-for-all here. But don't worry, everybody gets free healthcare. Whoops. You know, that's another head turner, right? I mean, the way they market it was, hey, don't worry, everybody's gonna get free healthcare. Pretty much so. That's what people are led to believe. Now it's this nightmare. It's an absolute nightmare. Total nightmare. Another great reason to trade in this world. Monastic world, I don't think people will get sick. That's not its purpose, see? It's not its purpose. And if something gets out of balance, there's spiritual practices to help that out. Absolutely. You see, in this world, the cat's out of the bag entirely with all this technology now. You can't put it back in. How are you going to put it back in? I mean, it's just a matter of time before this starts happening. I just see, oh my gosh. This is nuts. Just an extreme can of worms. Extreme concern. This planet is now just inundated with extreme concerns. The idea of somehow fixing all this in the planet is ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. So, I would say exchange planets. Exchange planets, exchange dwelling places. Exchange material world, this material world, for a monastic world. You won't have to worry about building houses, maintaining houses, fixing this and this and that. The buildings there somehow, they're, you know, they're ideally suited to last a long, long time with no maintenance. So you don't have to worry about all that. Some of the buildings that were built in the past of stone, beautifully built of stone in the last thousands of years. You don't get termite rot. You have termites. You have to replace the roof every 10 years. In California, it's absolutely ridiculous, the housing here. It's done somewhat because of earthquakes. They don't want to build buildings of concrete or brick or stone, things like that. So everything is flimsy in terms of the house goes. You have to replace stuff every, you know, the roofs come off like every, 15 years or so? New roof, tear the roof off, new roof. So much money is poured into maintenance of the homes here. They're only built to last, you know, 50 years or so, the homes. It's insane. Yeah, some a little longer, but the wire, everything gets old and decrepit. And you know, it's nothing to knock down a house that's 60 years old, just completely demolish it. It's finished. 60 years. What kind of economy? How can you keep spending all your time and effort like that? I want a house that lasts 1,000 years, 2,000 years. Don't have to worry about it at all. You can leave your house, and it's not, you know, you're not going to come back and it's all flooded and all the sheetrock is ruined and the hardwood floor is ruined and, you know, everything's ruined because some water got in there. The troubles that homeowners have here is just insane. Totally absurd. Build a home so, you know, it cannot be, floods will not damage it, termites will not damage it, storms. The one thing that causes earthquakes is the problem. Now, monastic world, we'd have a world without earthquakes for sure, without tornadoes for sure. See, the weather there is just like, it's controlled by our own beliefs, what we want. And since the beliefs there are repentant beliefs system, there's no need for nasty weather at all. Everything is smooth, cool, gentle, harmonious weather. Okay. Not tricky, slick and tricky. Right? Not slick and tricky and passive aggressive and all this. No, just beautiful, calm weather. And if you want, you can collectively have play of clouds, beautiful clouds, and various things like that. But it's always gentle. It's not vindictive or spiteful or vindictive or ferocious or anything like that. So you don't have the maintenance issues. You do not have the maintenance issues there. Very important, very important. You do not have to worry about maintaining this world. Your focus is spiritual focus. Evaporating the continuity fear is everybody's business. That's the business of that world. So you have to know that business. If you know the business, you say, oh, I can do business here. The business is evaporating the continuity fear. And you will not have this massive history there of all this philosophy we have in here in this world. You know, it's horrible, the philosophy here from, Aristotle on and before that. And then Aristotle and going through all these people. Everyone's trying to figure this world out and explain it. So torturous, you know, so absolutely torturous. Don't have any of that there. Because what you have there is actual practice of simply evaporating the continuity fear. That's it. So everybody knows. What is there? You're going towards no explanation, actually, because reality is totally self-evident. So it's very simple. Very simple. Gives me a little break. Maybe you need a little break. Talking about what about how would it be to exchange the material world for monastic world? How would that be? This is basically what I'm saying. How would it be? How would that be? This is what was introduced to me this morning. It's like, how would it be to exchange the material with this world for a monastic world? I said, huh, that might be a nice exchange. And again, I tell you for sure, there is no university or even monastery, any place in this world getting into it. It's the booby prize for sure. Really. I mean, if you say, well, you want to get into Oxford or Harvard, are you kidding? I wouldn't go into those places if you paid me all the money in the world. If you said, here's a scholarship for $1 trillion, you get to go to Stanford, I'd say, no, thank you. No, thank you. Keep your money. Absolutely. So where would you go in this world if you had a scholarship? Someone said, I'm going to give you a scholarship somewhere. Any place to go in this world? I don't think so. First of all, you need a staffed by an enlightened master to start off with, and it's probably quite a few of them. And then great, great other teachers under them. That's a bare minimum. Okay, you'd also need a situation, you know, that's not subject to this world, really, the problems at all. It's ridiculous. There are no deals in this world anymore. There's no deals at all. And this is what the goddess is trying to hide from you. The mother, you know, the mother says, oh, don't worry, child. Just do what I tell you to do. Stay in this world. This is where it's at. And you can't afford that anymore. Okay, you can't afford to hoodwink yourself with the mother, telling you how everything's so wonderful here. Again, what scholarship would you accept in this world? They say, you can have whatever deal, whatever you want. Now, nothing's a deal here anymore in this world. Nothing is a bargain at all. There are no bargains, no deals. Someone doesn't like you, attach a location device on your car. 2 miles away, they've got a little drone, send a drone up, come to your car, kaboom. That's it. Yeah. The way, they can put these tiny little RF chip, location devices and stuff, it's getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. It's going to be spy versus spy in this world, just this nightmare of, I better not offend anybody. I might get somebody mad, I'm not sure. Everybody's like, I hope nobody doesn't, nobody's mad at me, What kind of freedom is that? Can you express truth here? No. What kind of deal is there in this world? There's no good deals at all. Don't think that the activists of the world are going to suddenly become non-activists. It doesn't happen that way. The activists of the 60s are still activists. They didn't become non-activists. They moved their activism into other areas, but no, the activists remain activists by and large. A few repent. A few fortunate ones repent. What if somebody said to you, hey, I'm going to give you this position. You get to be like an executive vice president, Apple Computer, head of product, working on product development, or Google or something. You couldn't pay me all the money in the universe. You couldn't pay me to take that job. All the perks in the world, I wouldn't take that job. Thanks, but no thanks. Forget it. Are you kidding? So start to go through the idea of wonderful positions in this world. And start to ask yourself, is there really any wonderful position in this world at all? There's not a university in this world I would want to attend, not a job that I would want to take. There's no deals here whatsoever. No deals here whatsoever. None. Not a single deal here in this world. And so start to look at it from that perspective. Start to be aware of that. This is part of examining your valuing of this world. And it's sort of a light goes on in your mind. Say, hey, wait a minute, Yeah. Is this world really that great? I'm going to think that some house here is I've got it made, I've got this house, now I've got, but I'm in this world of technical mayhem here, and materialistic brainwashing, fear-based police system, trying to, a severe continuity problem I'm not even working on, completely distracted, building up bad habits of attention. This is a deal? This is a deal? Keep in mind, the monastic community, the job is to make itself unnecessary because you graduate. You realize that you are formless. Always been formless, actually. Now, there are examples in this world of those who simply turned on the light. Their bodies just started getting lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter. Just turned into light, see? They just no longer held their appearance as a body. Or they can just reappear as a body too. This has happened throughout history. And so we'll be able to do that at some point. At some point. You just realize it's just all just appearance. And it's moment by moment. There's nothing binding it, no circumstance or situation binding anything whatsoever. So you won't be living there forever, that kind of thing. You'll graduate. You will graduate. You may go to the supernature, death-free realm from a monastic realm. That is possible. See? So, there are possibilities coming up. Keep examining your valuing of this world and say, hey, is this world really a deal? Is there any really something that I really want here? This is, I feel like it's a really good deal. This is really good for me, given the overall circumstances of this planet, the overall circumstances, this, you know, hideous healthcare situation where I don't have a clue. I can't even function here anymore. I have no clue of what to do whatsoever. Paid no attention to it. I said, forget it. It's nasty. The way we're going towards just everything, the economic, the way things are being restructured, political situation, the ideological conflict. This is just a nasty world, just a super nasty world. By design. So we can imagine that we have somehow separated from God. Look how terrible, look how this is all so awful. I can't be in reality. I must have separated from it. All fake, you know, all fake. It's just a waste of time. It's delay central here, delay central. So we shouldn't have to feel that we are bound. This is the only place we can be. Only place we can use to evaporate our continuity fear. Why should we believe that? Because this is like the worst place. In other words, it's a place where we can really develop bad habits, which is what we're trying to do. So we can claim, well, I can't possibly be not be separate from God, because look at the situation I'm in. And keep in mind, there's no such thing as situations. There are no situations. That's all self-deception. But the self-deception here, this is self-deception central in this world. So of course the people, those spirits who want this, are very boosterish about it, say, wow, you can't find a better place than this. Well, if you want self-deception, that's probably true. You can't find a better place if you want self-deception. But if you want to be free of self-deception, it's not such a good place at all. And it's quite interesting, this sort of vague dread that people have about the future. Now the cat's out of the bag. I saw what it is. I said, uh-oh. Holy cow. I mean, it's just a nightmare. The capacity for rogue, well, just antagonistic elements in this world, too. They can genetically engineer all sorts of super bugs. You know, deliver it all over the place. There's the whole nightmare of aggressiveness in the world is suddenly going to take a quantum leap here. A quantum leap. The conflict that in cyber, I mean cyber warfare, I mean China says that the next world war, it will be a cyber war. And they're training millions and millions and millions of cyber soldiers, actually. And so we think, oh yeah, everything's fine. No, it isn't, because this cyber warfare can crash financial systems. It can mess up information systems. It can wreak havoc with our functioning like that. Stock market, you know, can be crashed through cyber warfare. So we're living in an extremely insecure situation. And of course people are frantically, you know, trying to protect the cyber warfare by ever and ever and ever more complex, sophisticated systems and encryption. And who in the world wants to live in such a situation? No thanks. I hate complexity. I hate passwords. I hate identification papers. I hate, you know, all of this, what this world is. There's no why. Now you know why. Now you know why. If you can just sort of full stop in this and just say, oh, okay, just full stop, just spiritual practice. Say, wow. Yeah. Just like in the American Revolution, everybody had a musket. You know, all the farmers, they all had muskets, and so they were able to, you know, defeat the great, you know, British Empire. Well, in the days that come, everybody will have drones. Everyone will have drones, just to use as they see fit. How about that? How about that? I remember somebody, Apple's building their big campus in Sunnyvale, Homestead Road there. And I remember someone saying that someone was flying a drone taking pictures of the construction. They have these huge fences all around. I don't know how, like 10-foot walls. You can't see anything that's going on inside. There's like the whole ultra secret. You can't see in at all. So somebody sent a drone up with a video camera. Just some kid or something. I mean, it's photographing the whole thing, you know, and everybody's all freaked out, like, we gotta find out who's doing that, you know. It just shows you, right? there goes all this super secret privacy, you know. Just some kid sent a drone up with a video camera, with a GoPro or something, or whatever they use. So probably sitting in his house with a smartphone, or sitting in a car. Riderless cars, you know, cars could be programmed to carry out missions, attack missions, etc. No riders in the car at all. It goes on and on and on and on and on. So it's like we've put our whole lives into the hands of these cyber criminals of this whole world. Who wants that? That is utter nonsense. Utter nonsense. Everything's going paperless, you know, so somebody can hack you. You're constantly worried about hackers. I don't download anything. I have a virus on my computer now. I don't know how it got there. And if I click, it's going to download something, you know, kind of thing. I'm afraid to download anything. Whenever I download something, it usually causes severe problems, or it doesn't load properly. You know, it's a nightmare. So I just say, well, I stay off, you know, almost all sites, stay off of them. Just go to YouTube, and that's almost it. Wikipedia. It's a jungle filled with landmines out there. You know, is this the world? Is this the deal? Is it, are we saying, God, how fortunate I am to be living here right now. This is like the ultimate. Or are we saying, this is absolutely horrible. How unfortunate am I? So it depends, right? Some see it one way, some see it the other way. I most certainly see it as how incredibly unfortunate we are with driving cars just weaving with super close tolerances at high speeds. It's just normal now. It's normal. Where you're just saying, whoa, almost hit me. Whoa, almost hit me. Wow, this is scary. Whew, suddenly a car just like, they don't even signal. They just swerve in front of you and then swerve in the next lane and go around and swerve like this. And, you know, and it locks you in. So even the driving here is hideous now. I mean, one of the great things California's driving, you know, the wide open roads. We loved it out west. It's hideous now. The driving experience is hideous. It's like you think you're going to die or get in an accident. The drivers are so aggressive and crazy. So. Is that a deal? If I say, oh, I'm going to go out for a Sunday drive. No, not anymore. I used to say that. Say, hey, let's drive down this area and just drive around, look at the homes and the beautiful scenery, and let's just get a bite to eat and relax. Now it's like, no, no way. I don't want to drive. I don't want to get on the freeway. Are you kidding? Oh, well, it's a Saturday afternoon. Are you kidding? It's jammed. There's no time you can go out when it's not jammed with cars. Aggressive drivers. Everybody uptight, you know. Holy cow, this happened to me just on the city, just town streets. car at a traffic light didn't like the fact that I delayed maybe like 1 second before I went after turn green. They expect you to instantly floor it. So I just took a nice smooth, you know, so no stress, no worry. Zoomed around me on the right and is a turn lane, and then cut across four lanes into a left turn lane, and then had to sit there waiting for the signal anyway. Meanwhile, like shaking me up, like, wow, look at this maniac. What in the world are they up to? Just flooring it, you know, and going around on the right side, just because they were upset that it didn't immediately floor it after the light turned green at a stoplight. This is what we're dealing with here. You know, people are losing their minds. And of course, this impacts the quality. I mean, going places, Californians are all about going places. The quality experience of traveling there, driving there, going someplace to the market, wherever you're going, it's like, ah, this is great, relaxed, casual living here. It's not anymore. It's a nightmare. The idea of going downtown is like unthinkable. Nobody goes downtown anymore. It's the congestion, just the parking. You can't find any parking anywhere. Well, I went down to get this, but it took me half an hour. I couldn't find park. It's horrible. You just don't even go downtown. So building going up constantly, new apartment buildings and stuff, it's going to get worse and worse and worse. So the whole atmosphere has been ruined. The whole quality of life is just collapsing. And yet, the goddess keeps telling us how fortunate we are, that we're entering a golden age and everything is going to be perfect here. And we'll get everything's, you know, what? What kind of propaganda is this? And we're shown these people with, you know, Botoxed lips and you know, beak jobs that are like decaying and stuff. And we said, look at how beautiful you're going to be in the future. You can look like this, you know. You can have all this plastic surgery on your body and you're going to be so happy. This is the idiocy that we're being taught. We can have all this plastic surgery. This is going to make us happy, right? So think about exchanging this world, material world, this dystopian nightmare for a monastic world where you will feel a million incomparably more fortunate than if you got into Stanford or Harvard or Oxford or wherever, MIT. Infinitely more fortunate. And everybody there knows it. Everybody there knows it, you see. This is one of the big things. You see, like at Stanford, you get into Stanford, everybody there thinks that they've reached the top. And so they all feel like this feeling. You get this affirmation from everybody like, yeah, you're really important. You're really somebody. You're at the very top echelon here. You're super fortunate. And so they get this kind of collective like entitlement thing. Like, this is great, this is great. And so where in the monastic world, everybody there knows how fortunate you are. So just by being there, this is the attitude everyone has. Like, you get into the monastic world, you know, that's something. And I already got my invitation from Jesus. I already got it. And so, it's not like you feel like, wow, I must not, you know, I don't know what I'm doing. No, you realize everybody's like, hey, this is the big time, man. You're super fortunate. We're all super fortunate here. So this attitude, we're all super, super fortunate to be here. This is fantastic. This is wonderful. And it doesn't take long until you start feeling this gratitude and your whole spirit's, you know, just saying, wow, this is just great. What a great job the Holy Spirit did. What a tough marketing job it is here in this world to try to market this to anybody. Now, the Christians say they're going to be in the rapture, some of them, and they'll be there with the throne of Jesus, and I don't know, dwelling with them in something or other, but, you know, be realistic here. Aim for the monastic world where you have the opportunity to evaporate your continuity fear. whole rapture thing is so vague. And are these people really prepared for the formless perfection of reality? No continuity of God. Are they prepared? Are you kidding? So it's a very vague sort of thing. I'm saying, nailing it down, monastic world here. You get to spend as much time as you need, gradually moving your comfort zone towards a no explanation at all, which means towards perfect self-evidency, towards perfect self-evidency. Get to move your comfort zone to perfect self-evidency. And some people here in the world say, well, they have my favorite TV programs. I don't want to miss those. No, they won't have those. But you won't miss them at all. You won't miss them at all. The difference between driving, being in the shark tank, driving through streets and just hell here, and you escape to some resort or something. There's just like this beautiful, pristine, private golf course or something. And you go out there, and it just, after a while, you just say, wow. Forget all about the world. Forget all about it. This is so nice. See, it's so nice. So quiet, so peaceful. No cops hiding. Give me a ticket for not driving the golf cart right, you know. It's, cops are all over the place now. Hiding everywhere, trying to give people tickets. You have to drive, you know, just like fearfully drive. Who wants to be in this fear state here, which is what the world is? Everybody's afraid of getting cited for something, right? Oh, and let me add another layer to this world, which is amazing what I'm experiencing. No, everybody's afraid to give you any advice whatsoever in this world for fear of being sued. I was in a car parts place, and I ordered something, and I said, hey, you know, is this part, you know, easy or difficult to install? And they say, I cannot tell you, I cannot answer that question, sir. I don't know your technical skill. I say, oh, you mean you're covering your behind, huh? You're afraid of lawsuits? I say, yes, can't tell you anything. So you can't even say, is this like a big deal? Is it complicated or anything? Or is it fairly simple? You can't even give me an indication. He says, no, I can't. I can't give you even. I say, can you nod your head or just not say anything? I say, if I say, is it easy? If you just be quiet, does that mean it is? And I can't tell you anything, sir. Get this all the time. Everybody is terrified of lawsuits, and everyone has been trained, don't say anything except have a nice day. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. Here's your product. Have a nice day, whatever. So nobody's dispensing advice anymore. Who wants to live in such a hellhole? We're already there. We brought a tire in to get it fixed, and they say, I'm sorry, this tire... It was just a, you know, little leak, easy to fix. They said, we can't fix it. I said, what do you mean? Well, it's over 5 years old. The tire's over 5 years old. I said, so? We can't fix any tires over 5 years old. What? Legally. You know, we don't want to be liable for anything like that. If anything happens, we can be sued. Huh? So wherever you go, you run into every business in the world is terrified of being sued. And is their whole mindset is, they're in their interactions with you, you are a potential litigant against them, okay? Therefore, they're covering themselves at all costs. Smiling, hello, how are you? Have a nice day. Don't you dare sue me. I'll make sure you won't can't sue me. So there's this weird vibe in the world. Like, so what's wrong with people? Is fear of lawsuits, fear of getting sued is extreme in this world. Same, and fear of losing their job. Oh my gosh. I mean, somebody said to me working, he said Christmas, and he said, oh, like that. He's talking about, yeah, this Christmas, I can't say that word, he said. We're not allowed to say that word. It's the holiday season. Don't let anyone know I said Christmas. was worried. He could tell I was okay with it, but it's like, you could tell, it's like, no. There's all this rules and regulations. They don't dare do stuff. He could lose his job. If somebody goes around and says, hey, Merry Christmas, fired. If they continue, probably. Soon they'll be even say Merry Christmas. You'll be fired from your job. Is this the kind of world, is this a deal? Thank you, guys. We're so fortunate to live in such a world where we can't say Merry Christmas. And the guy says, oh, don't worry, you'll have great sex. You know, all the women know how to have, you know, everyone's real great sex. That was wonderful, you know. Really, but I can't say Merry Christmas, you know. I think that's more important, right? Be able to say Merry Christmas. Why can't I? I have to watch every word with paranoia. What kind of quality of life is that? So the goddess is always saying, oh, great music, great sex, great drugs, you know, don't worry. You'll be happy. But if you really look past this, you realize this is just a spiel by a marketing moron, you know, who, of course, we're employing the goddess to convince us to stay here. It's just a psychic projection. There isn't really any goddess at all. It's a psychic projection that we're using to convince ourselves to stay here. So, of course, we make it seem like irresistible. We have to do it. We believe it. Believe in the goddess. But if you look at it, it's absolute nonsense. Don't worry. We have got all sorts of surgical procedures. We'll have, you know, well, it's a nightmare, isn't it, going into hospitals and getting surgical procedures. And don't worry, you have all these medications, you'll be fine. My doctors tell us, hey. Or my doctor says, hey. I get doctors telling me, don't take this stuff. Everything has side effects. You'll end up on more and more and more. I have med technicians telling me, this is terrible. Stay away. This place is like a gas chamber, really. I mean, the whole thing. It's nasty. And of course, we're being told we're like the fortunate ones here in this world. Like, we got into Stanford, we got into planet Earth. It's like incredible how fortunate you are, we're told. You know, what a bunch of brainwashing going on here. You know, it's really welcome to the ghetto. You know, how fortunate you are to live in absolute squalor and fear and intimidation for your whole life. One, why do you say it's fortunate? Because it's this is a great place to deceive yourself, you know, and to deceive God, try to deceive God. What, you know, is custom made for this? Well, what if we don't want to deceive God? But everybody does, they say. No, not everybody does. Actually, we're tired of it. It's boring. It's very boring, actually. This whole thing is incredibly boring. This world is, you know, terminally boring, actually. Yeah, but look at the dress this starlet is wearing, you know. Wow. Even more boring, you know. It's all boring. And we're supposed to say, oh yeah, this great. My life is fulfilled now because this, what the starlet's wearing on the red carpet. Oh yeah, this. Should be happy. He'd be happy forever here, right? Yeah. Complete lunacy here. Total goddess lunacy of marketing appearances, marketing materiality, marketing form, marketing process, marketing bodies, marketing drugs. You know. Don't worry about your health. Everyone has health care now. It's all beautiful. It's all wonderful. Y'all be happy. Keep in mind, we're just deceiving ourselves because we're afraid of any alternative. But the more we look at a monastic world, the more we realize, hey, that's way better. That is way, way better. Are you kidding? It's like detox. It's like, we're so toxified, we need to go to a detox world, just to detox from this one, for sure. And you'd be surprised. You see all these people and drug addicts go into detox and they come. But Even people seem really messed up going to detox. Be surprised, you'd be amazed. The rehabilitation, a monastic world, really rehabilitates you. Everybody is capable of being rehabilitated without exception, everyone. So this is just an idea. How would it be to exchange this material world for a really, really great monastic world? Someone like Longchenpa is there teaching, you know. Someone there like Jesus of Nazareth is teaching. Someone there saying, hey, I'm going to do some practices right now. So, you know, sit quietly here. Sit still. Don't move around. And we're going to go through these gradually and take your time. And and you start doing them. And that's not so difficult. That's great. Then you feel the wow. See, oh yeah, okay, the wow, okay, full stop in the burn. It's like, wow, full stop in the wow. Get used to it. And the next day, a month later, you're working on it, and you look back and say, wow, oh, I'm not, now I can think, do these practices, and there's no wow. I feel comfortable. This is natural for me. Progress right there. Feels easy, feels natural. So month by month by month, you feel more easy and more natural, more easy and more natural. It just goes like that. It just goes like that. As the months go by, you realize you're moving through a lot of territory. Your comfort zone is like getting closer and closer and closer to the ultimate goal. You say, yeah, this isn't so difficult. It's not so difficult. You just keep practicing. Just keep practicing. Keep your attention on it. Keep your attention on it. Keep practicing every day. And you know, you sort of breeze through it. And nobody's surprised. Nobody's surprised. Say, of course you're going to succeed. You will succeed. Don't worry, you'll succeed. This is what the gurus tell their students, the devotees come to them. Don't worry, you're going to get, you'll get it, don't worry. I'll help you out, make sure you get it, no problem. So they relax, you know, they relax and say, wow, okay. How great would that be? Those are the fortunate ones. But as long as we lust after this position in this world, that's not good. Remember, Jesus said, don't lay up your treasure in this world, lay up in the world to come. Which I believe is the monastic world. So don't be, you know, angling for position and power in this world. Don't be ambitious in this world. Be ambitious to get into the world that is to come. And that world that is to come, meaning the alternative world, the alternative to this world here. The world that will be available for you, right? Try to get into that world. Make that your aim. So at this moment, we're not worrying about the details. We're saying the idea. How would it be to exchange the material world for the monastic world? How would that be? Well, I won't make a name for myself in this world. That's okay. Who wants to make a name for themselves here? That's a waste of time. Any name for yourself here you make here, pretty much so later on you'll feel disgusted with it anyway. Say, no, I don't want that name. Forget it. I don't want to be known. So, making a name in a world is completely overrated. Something that you should not even try to do. This world will pass away and everything with it. There'll be no memories of it at all. So, don't place your treasures in this world. It's okay to be a no name in this world. In fact, it's great. this is one of the more like scary ones, kind of. Depends on each person, but it's like, oh, I'll be unknown here. No record of you ever being here. Well, good. Who wants to be known in a ghetto? King of the ghetto. If you could be sitting with Longchenpa in a monastery, you know, who wants to be trying to make a name in a ghetto, you know? That's the options, that's the option, like, you know? Yeah, funny. I thought I brought everything in last night. This book was left out, Spaciousness. By Longchenpa, you know? Who wants to be queen of this world if you can be sitting with Longchenpa, being coached? People think that the queen of this world is such a high position that Longchenpa would find it like an honor to help the queen of this world out. As if the queen of this world is much higher than Longchenpa. I mean, that's not the way that the masters think at all. They give no thought to your name in this world or position whatsoever. None. They don't view the world that way. It's all about your practice, all about your commitment, all about your effort, dedication, patience, willingness. It's all about that. And it's not a privilege for them, so to speak. In some way you can say, but no, it's you're the fortunate one to get access to them. The queen of this world thinks that sitting with her is way better than sitting with Longchenpa. How could anyone even compare the two, you know? But you're in this world, you're sitting with someone who doesn't have a clue. Just a psychic projection, marketing self-deception. How is that fortunate? How is that fortunate? Yeah, but everyone will think you're high and mighty. Well, if those fallen into extreme self-deception think that you're wonderful, high and mighty, how is that a good thing? Wouldn't you rather be with someone who knows the way than being given adulation by the masses? How does that help you? They have no clue what the way is. So how does that get, you know? See, this is the problem. We can have millions of people in our Twitter account, but none of those millions have a clue of the way to salvation. Or you can be sitting with someone who knows the way, so which is better? And have nobody on it, not even have a Twitter account. Have a million friends on Facebook and none of them have a clue. In fact, they all have bad habits of attention. And or you can have one friend who knows the way to salvation and can coach you. Which is more advantageous? these are some interesting questions to ask. Very heavy stuff, right? I find it pretty, very heavy. It's like, wow. It's a shocker. So, very great. Just let this full stop with this. Quite. This is probably enough for this one. We'll see where this gets us. This has broken a lot of new ground, actually, hasn't it? It's a groundbreaking video. For sure. But that's what this is all about. You have to keep breaking ground. Okay, very great. That's it.